Okay, so we're going to talk about the integration of metabolism. So we've talked about some of the major pathways in cellular respiration, which is taking one molecule of glucose through glycolysis, converting it to two molecules of pyruvate, converting those pyruvate to acetyl-CoA. Acetyl-CoA goes into the citric acid cycle. And then all of the electron carriers that have been loaded up through that whole process are going to the electron transport chain, and we're making ATP. So glucose is obviously not the only fuel that our cells can use to make ATP. We also have other fuel sources like protein and fats. If you look at the beginning of this lecture, there is a PowerPoint slide that shows all of the different types of metabolic pathways, and then highlighted in yellow are the things that we're going to focus on, or the things that we have already focused on. So we've really talked about so far, we have talked about sugar metabolism. We also will talk about lipid metabolism. Amino acid metabolism. And nucleotide metabolism. So these are the four classes of macromolecules. And remember, way back in the beginning, we said that only these three provide energy. So we've talked about sugar metabolism and the amount of ATP that we can get out of one molecule of glucose. In the next few chapters, we'll talk about lipid metabolism, which is using fatty acids as energy. We'll talk about amino acid metabolism, where we can break apart our skeletal muscle for energy. And then we'll talk about nucleotide metabolism, how we make the nucleotides that are in our DNA and RNA, but we do not use those for energy. So this lecture is all about how all of these pathways are regulated, why some are preferred over others, which ones are active, which ones are inactive, and molecules and ways that pathways are regulated. So, especially pathways that are involved in the production of energy are very tightly regulated because we don't want to be making ATP if we don't need it. We don't want to be using ATP if we don't need it. So, all very tight regulation is happening on all of these types of pathways. So, let's talk about ATP again for a minute. So ATP has two metabolic roles. So the first major role of ATP is ATP hydrolysis is largely energetically favorable, so we use ATP to drive thermodynamically unfavorable reactions. So we've talked about this now when we talked about thermodynamics and now seeing ATP be formed both two ways, substrate level phosphorylation and then oxidative phosphorylation. Another role that ATP has that we haven't talked about yet is that it's an important allosteric effector in the regulation of metabolic pathways. So think about what this means. It's an allosteric effector. So ATP is going to activate some types of reactions. ATP is going to inhibit other types of reactions or other pathways. So remember we said that catabolic pathways produce energy? They produce ATP. If you're in a situation where there's a lot of intracellular ATP, then extra ATP is going to inhibit catabolic processes, pathways. ATP will mostly activate anabolic pathways. And this isn't true for every single situation, but for the most part, ATP, which is an energy source, is going to activate pathways that require energy, and it's going to inhibit pathways that produce energy. This is an example of feedback inhibition. Feedback inhibition is where the product will inhibit further production of itself. So if you're in a pathway that is producing ATP, once enough ATP has been made, that ATP would then be an allosteric effector of some of the enzymes in that pathway. So this is preventing unnecessary pathways from being active all of the time. Okay, so we are going to look at one example of covalent regulation of enzyme activity by what's called a second messenger, which is called cyclic AMP. So we have ATP. Now we're going to introduce another molecule called cyclic AMP. So remember, AMP is adenosine monophosphate. ATP is adenosine or adenine triphosphate. So cyclic AMP is usually abbreviated little c, big AMP. So this is what's called a second messenger. And there are a lot of examples of these second messengers that are important in regulating metabolic pathways. Cyclic AMP is just one that we are going to choose to focus on because we're going to see how it is important in some of the specific pathways that we'll cover. So this is an example of covalent regulation of enzyme activity. And it's covalent regulation because it involves reversible phosphorylation. Okay, so this is on slide number 31. And I'm not going to write out all of the steps because you can see it there. You'll see that this entire process with this second messenger is triggered by a hormone. This hormone is either going to be insulin or glucagon. And I'm not going to tell you which it is because this is going to be a test question. We're going to talk all about this, and then I'm going to ask you a test question about cyclic AMP specifically. So this whole process is going to be initiated by a hormone. And what the hormone does is it activates an enzyme called adenylyl cyclase. And what adenylyl cyclase does is it converts ATP to cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP then activates a kinase. Remember what a kinase is. A kinase is an enzyme that phosphorylates something. It activates this, what's called cyclic AMP-dependent protein kinase. That active protein kinase then goes on to activate another enzyme called active phosphorylase kinase. And what phosphorylase kinase does is it activates glycogen phosphorylase. So we're going to talk all about glycogen synthesis later. Remember, glycogen is the way that we store glucose. So we're going to talk all about this in a little bit, but this is an important slide on slide number 31. It shows this process of how this second messenger, cyclic AMP, is involved in regulation of these enzymes because they are phosphorylating an enzyme to make it active. So the inactive form of the enzyme would not be phosphorylated, and then once it becomes phosphorylated, now it's active. So again, this is on slide number 31, and it walks you through this whole process. Again, it says that this is all started by a hormone, and we'll talk about these types of hormones that activate or inactivate glycogen synthase or glycogen phosphorylase when we talk about that later. This will be a test question on the next test. Okay. It also shows what's called modulator proteins. Hang on, let me make sure I was on the right slide for you guys here. Yeah. This was the wrong slide. This is actually slide number 15. My pages got stuck. So this is actually slide number 15, sorry, not 31, where it talks about cyclic AMP. And then it shows on slide number 17, it shows modulator proteins and the active and inactive forms of these enzymes and how cyclic AMP specifically activates these enzymes. So this is all shown in the slides. So we're going to talk about some control sites of some major metabolic pathways. And again, this is all in the slides, but a lot of these are opposing pathways. And what's important here, what I want you to see, is that usually feedback inhibition is involved in these major metabolic pathways regulation. So, for example, a pathway that produces pyruvate is going to be inhibited by pyruvate because if there's a lot of pyruvate around, that's going to cause feedback inhibition and reduce the activity of that pathway. Glycolysis is the first step. Another thing, so we need to pay attention to feedback inhibition. We also need to pay attention to the cellular location. So, for example, glycolysis takes place in the cytosol, and depending on where some of these other processes happen, that regulation will be dependent on the location. So, for example, we know glycolysis happens in the cytosol of all cells. We know gluconeogenesis, which is the opposite process, happens in the cytosol, but it only happens in the liver and the kidneys. So you need to know the cellular location. You also need to know the organ where these processes are happening. So glycolysis happens in all cells. Gluconeogenesis only happens in the liver and the kidneys. And we said how these were reciprocally regulated. So something that activates glycolysis is going to inhibit gluconeogenesis because these are opposite processes, and most of this is feedback inhibition. So take a look at these and see how glycolysis and gluconeogenesis are reciprocally regulated. Same with the citric acid cycle. The citric acid cycle only happens in the mitochondria, and it's inhibited by high ATP because ATP is a product of the citric acid cycle. So if there's high ATP, that's going to inhibit this process. Same with NADH. NADH is also a product of the citric acid cycle, so high NADH will inhibit the citric acid cycle. And there are slides for each of these. Those are the only ones that I'm going to spend a lot of time on talking about right now, because the next few pathways we haven't covered yet. The next pathway in the notes is called the pentose phosphate pathway. The pentose phosphate pathway is a pathway that we use to produce nucleotides from glucose, glucose 6-phosphate. So nucleotides have a sugar in them. Deoxyribose is in DNA, ribose is in RNA. Both of those are sugars. So the precursors from these nucleotides actually come from glucose 6-phosphate, which is the first step in glycolysis. So I'm not going to talk a lot about the pentose phosphate pathway until we talk about nucleotides. The next one is about glycogen. So remember glycogen, we'll talk about this for a little bit here. Glycogen is how we store glucose. So there's two processes that are happening. There is glycogen synthase and glycogenolysis. So I'll say glycogen synthesis, and then I'll say glycogenolysis. Again, the name tells you what's happening. So glycogen synthesis, this would be the synthesis or production of glycogen. Why would you be producing glycogen? You'd be producing glycogen because you have too much glucose. The reason that you store glucose is because you have too much of it. Glycogenolysis, lysis means breaking apart, this would be the production of glucose from glycogen. So this glycogen is this long chain of stored glucoses. In glycogenolysis, you're cutting one glucose off at a time. That glucose can then go back into the bloodstream and be used. So when would you undergo glycogenolysis? When you have low glucose. So these are two opposite processes. Glycogen synthesis happens when you have too much glucose and you need to store glucose as glycogen. Glycogenolysis happens when you have low glucose and you need to use some of that glucose that you've stored as glycogen, but you need to break it off of that chain of glycogen before you can use it. So there's two enzymes here that are working. So for glycogen synthesis, we have an enzyme called glycogen synthase. So glycogen synthase is the enzyme that causes the glucose to form glycogen. The other enzyme, I'm running out of space here, is called glycogen phosphorylase. Glycogen phosphorylase is the enzyme that gets activated when we don't have enough glucose in our bloodstreams, so we want to break off individual glucose from the stored glycogen. So you'll see that these two enzymes are reciprocally regulated. Only one of these will be active at a time. If there's too much glucose, glycogen synthase will be activated so we can store the glucose as glycogen. If there's not enough glucose, glycogen phosphorylase will be activated, and it will be activated to cause the glucose to break off of the glycogen. Because we have low glucose, we want to put some back in our bloodstream. So these enzymes are both regulated by hormones. These hormones, insulin and glucagon. These two hormones are responsible for reading the level of blood glucose and activating or inactivating these enzymes. Glucagon, you can think about this like the glucose is gone. Glucagon is going to activate glycogen phosphorylase. Glucagon activate glycogen phosphorylase, which is going to put the glucose back in our bloodstream because the glucose is gone. So we want to put the glucose that's stored in the glycogen back in our bloodstream. Insulin, so this happens at low glucose concentration. Insulin is the opposite. Insulin is the hormone that is secreted when there is high glucose, a high glucose concentration. And insulin is going to activate glycogen synthase. When we have high blood glucose, insulin activates glycogen synthase through this cyclic AMP. Both of these use cyclic AMP, but depending on the level of glucose, will determine which of these hormones are active and which enzyme is going to cause glucose to be put back into our bloodstream or glucose to be taken out of our bloodstream. And remember, all of this, managing blood glucose levels, this is an example of homeostasis. So again, this goes back to the cyclic AMP second messenger. This is on slide number 15. There will be a test question about this on exam 2.